our meeting tonight. Honorable members of City Council, in accordance with the Virginia Beach City Code 2-21, and by the authority vested in me as mayor of the City of Virginia Beach, I hereby call a special meeting of the Virginia Beach City Council, Tuesday, May 12th, 2020, 5:30 p.m., City Council Chamber, Building 1, City Hall, 2nd floor, 2401 Courthouse Drive. The purpose of this special meeting is for the City Council to receive briefings regarding COVID-19 update, City Manager search update, and to consider the fiscal year 2020-2021 resource management plan, operating budget, capital improvement budget, and related ordinances to provide current year 2019 to 2025 taxpayer assistance. No public comment will be taken at this meeting. However, because it's expected that three or more members of the council will be physically present at the meeting, limited seating is for the public will be available in the City Council chamber. Members of council may participate via electronic communication means provided that a quorum of City Council is physically present at the meeting location and that the City Council member provides notice that he or she is unable to physically attend the meeting for the reasons set forth in City Council policy for remote participation by council member in City Council meetings adopted March 31st, 2020, attached. Appropriate social distancing shall be observed, and citizens are encouraged to wear protective face coverings. This special meeting will be broadcast on cable, TV, www.vbgov.com, and Facebook Live. Citizens are encouraged to submit the comments to the City Council prior to the special meeting via email at citycouncil@vbgov.com. Bobby Dyer, Mayor. Okay, we're gonna have the call to order. We do have everybody present, Madam Clerk?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, at this point, Mr. Manager, I believe we have some updates.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, we have updates on the COVID-19 is Dr. Lindsay. So first up would be Dr. Demetria Lindsay from the Virginia Beach Health Department. Before Dr. Lindsay gets started, earlier today I sent you an email indicating that we had, for the first time in over a month, we had two new positive cases confirmed in the workforce. As timing would have it, I just got notified a few minutes before coming into the meeting that we've had two more. So now we have a total of four cases in the workforce. They're fairly well isolated. Contact investigation and cleaning is underway. So now we could turn it over to Dr. Lindsay.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, members of City Council. I have our latest update for COVID-19 response. Currently, we have 517 cases, 19 deaths. We have currently 85 hospitalized patients who are infected, and also 287 released from isolation, and 126 currently monitored and in self-isolation. So many of our cumulative cases are no longer active cases. We have 8 outbreaks. 5 have been in congregate settings and 3 in workplaces. Of those, the city manager, I believe, just mentioned one that is in a city department. This investigation is in its early stages at this time. Long-term care facilities have been a major source of outbreaks to date, and of course, they do pose unique challenges. National data shows multiple states with as much as 60% of their fatalities for COVID as being among long-term care residents. In Virginia Beach, 47% of our fatalities or 9 out of 19, have been in long-term care residents. While lower than the national average, this is still a priority group for extra preventive attention and testing when outbreaks do occur. One thing I will say in noting we're working with these long-term care facilities is that these are typically very well managed facilities. When we work with them to identify actions they may take to try to mitigate the outbreaks, we found that they are working hard and have taken many appropriate measures. It is just that it is a congregate setting. It is a setting of individuals who have many risk factors. Some of them have memory disorder or other skill challenges as well that make containment difficult, but they are managing appropriately. It is just a very challenging situation. The strategies that we are applying to make sure that long-term care facilities have appropriate PPE, have restricted visitors, that they adopt best practice techniques related to daily screening of staff and residents, appropriate hand hygiene, and have intensified cleaning and disinfection practices. When COVID cases do rise in a nursing facility, we assist the facility management staff in assessing the facility, arranging unit testing of patients and staff where indicated. The governor's Ford Virginia blueprint has also been a focus of much of our activity recently. The governor has outlined a phased approach grounded in CDC guidelines and VDH guidelines as well on how and when to safely begin easing public health restrictions to the public. He's identified several key indicators that must be met before this can happen. One includes a 14-day downward trend in confirmed cases as a percentage of overall tests, not overall individuals, but percentage of overall tests. As of May 15th, 16% of tests have been positive in the state, statewide, as well as 8% in Virginia Beach. There's also a requirement for a 14-day downward trend in COVID-19 hospitalizations, and current hospitalization rates have stabilized, while confirmed cases, however, have continued to rise. Enough hospital beds and intensive care capacity, and that has been maintained well below the capacity in the state and in our area. An increasing and sustainable supply of personal protective equipment, and we've seen much increase in availability of PPE lately. Attention has been focused on case investigation and contact tracing. Currently, case investigators and contact tracers are managing well in Virginia Beach on our reported cases and their contacts. A case is generally investigated within 24 hours of receipt of a report, which includes the interview to determine circumstances of exposure, health history, symptoms, and details of activities beginning 2 days prior to onset until the case is isolated. It is during this interview that household and close contacts are named. Shortly after the interview, the contacts are assigned for further investigation, placement in quarantine, and education on maintaining quarantine is also taking place and set up for monitoring during the quarantine process. An average of 2 contacts are usually identified that have to be investigated and monitored. And this is less than it was at the beginning when we had many contacts associated with travel. Our current number is low, largely due to the fact that we have had significant social isolation and closure of public facilities. We do expect a change as public facilities begin to reopen. We do expect to see increases in the average number of contacts per cases. While the workload is manageable currently, reopening activities will also soon need staff that we have shifted to this type of role, such as environmental manpower, the need for them to be replaced as they return to their usual areas of responsibility. And this will require us to has required us to think about how we may augment our staff further. So we're in the process of recruiting and training staff members for this effort. I'll speak to that in a minute. Total cases, again, looking at our cases, 466 at the time of this review. Our cases without interviews or contacts were 44 out of that 466. That represents less than 10% of cases investigated. And these are largely related to outbreaks associated with long-term care facilities where a case investigation is basically focused largely on that facility. Also, contacts identified 692, representing an average of 1.63 contacts per case. Cases not monitored include 80, which is about 11.5%. Those are largely cases that have passed a 14-day quarantine period. And cases interviewed in quarantine, 612, representing 88.5%. These are cases quarantined and monitored for 14 days after exposure. So with our current staffing, we have managed well and quite efficiently in these activities. As noted previously, VDH is actively working to augment staffing support for COVID-19 response, particularly focusing on currently our case investigations and contact tracing. There are two routes by which one can apply to be a part of this team. One is joining the MRC and the other through a state recruitment process. Since the beginning of our COVID-19 response, we have processed 250 additional volunteers into the Medical Reserve Corps. And we have an additional 350 in the queue currently to be processed. So we are actively recruiting and actively engaging volunteers in our workforce and are proud to see how Virginians, particularly Virginia Beach residents, are stepping up to support this outbreak. Currently, we also have a statewide recruitment process to hire staff to support our response. Interested parties can go directly to indeed.com or to our state Virginia Jobs Work website to apply. We're looking to hire as a state around 1,000 contract tracers, as well as supervisors, testing coordinators, case investigators, data management staff, and analytics staff. This recruitment, as I mentioned, is active. We will be hiring and training this month. Also, regarding MRC, additional highlights, VDH is currently identifying MRC statewide to support a contact tracing team to support an outbreak on the Eastern Shore. The Virginia Beach MRC currently has 23 volunteers being trained for this team. Here locally, we have a pool of 300 plus volunteers who have indicated they want to assist in contract tracing in Virginia Beach. Our MRC are also providing support in terms of staff for two long-term care facilities that have experienced a loss due to COVID infection. And we have several long-term care facilities that have benefited from this support. One facility with 314 hours donated and another one with 216 hours donated. In addition, our MRC and public health staff have been collaborating with City Occupational Health and EMS for fit testing for individuals in long-term care and other facilities to ensure that they have properly fitting N95 mask to ensure proper personal protective equipment. We have 16 currently trained MRC fit testers who are part of this process, with 30 MRC volunteers supporting one facility and 315 staff at three other facilities. That is all that I have at this time. I'm happy to answer any questions if there are any.
Any questions for Dr. Lindsay? John, and then Aaron.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dr. Lindsay, can you tell us what model the state is using for its forecasting? Are they using the one from Johns Hopkins? Are they one using from University of Virginia? I'm curious as to what model they are using and to what extent the model's predictions are aligning with actual experience.
The state has contracted with one of the local state universities. I believe that is VCU, and there is a state model that is being followed. I would have to do more research to give you specifics on exactly how close it is tracking to current findings.
How well it is predicting. And we're supposed to be having this 10,000 a day test. Do you know whether or not we are actually have achieved, when we're going to achieve that daily testing of 10,000 statewide?
That is a goal that the governor set starting this month. And we have Dr. Karen Rimley, a former health commissioner, and our state epidemiologist, Dr. Lillian Peake, are leading that workforce to actively work towards increasing those numbers. So that is a process that has started this month. It involves not only focusing on increasing testing in the public sector, but also the private sector as well. And it is well underway, but no, we are not at 10,000 a day at this point.
Question. I don't know if you watched Dr. Fauci's testimony today before the Senate. I don't know if you watched that or not, but I'm curious in the context of what he was talking about, that we've underestimated the being more aggressive at opening things. If we have any lessons learned or extrapolations we can make to our current experience and congregate situations, which are principally nursing homes, and there's a lot of other factors, but at a later date, how they're assessing the congregate larger group risk factors when they decide to have larger openings and larger aggregation of people. What does the model say we should expect in terms of increase fatalities or increased incidences of positive test cases? Because I think people are looking for, maybe that science doesn't exist, but I think those are the questions I hear from people. I got calls today from people who were watching the actual testimony live on TV, and I said, well, you know, I'm not a scientific or health professional, but I do think if you can take back a message to the folks at the state, people are looking for the scientific data they are relying upon in making their decisions so that people individually can assess their own risk. I do think they're looking for that kind of information. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You're quite welcome. Aaron?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dr. Lindsay, thank you again for that brief update. My question and my interest is falls in the lines of,
Dr. Lindsay? Oh, she's still there.
Okay, great. Thank you for that brief update. My question and interest falls in the lines of the contract tracers. I know the Dr. Daniel Carey, the Virginia Secretary of Health, as you stated, is looking to hire over 1,000 new contract tracers. You mentioned we have a pool of 300 volunteers who are willing to work and help us with contact tracing. How, and I'm curious too, is there a plan necessarily that's put forth and how those contact tracers, which the state would hire, how would that work with our pool of volunteers? Are the state necessarily contact tracers? Would they be, you know, revolving from region to region, or, you know, would there be a headquarters here? I'm interested in seeing how would our locality
get that information and necessarily add it to the state and work in conjunction with the state. Thank you.
So the districts will be working directly with the state on the hiring process. We're actually one of the locations, actually in Norfolk, one of the locations that will be involved in training staff who are assigned to this particular region. We will have our own contact tracers, and they will be accountable to the local health districts. And we will utilize volunteer and hired staff, both based upon our need. And there will be some regional supervisors to help support that. There's some coordination to ensure that if there should be a major outbreak in a particular area, there may be a need to call upon some staff in some areas to help support that, but we will have our own dedicated staff.
If I can follow up, that data that we will be gathering, will that data stay necessarily locally, or is that data we are going to coordinate throughout with the state?
Could you clarify what data you're referring to?
The contact tracing data. Are we keeping that data track of where people are necessarily coming from, the region they're coming from, in lines of that? Are we keeping that data? Are we tracking that, or are we just tracking just the you know, contact tracing from the last places, or they are traveling in between locally?
The case investigation and contact tracing are actually functions that are done here locally. We collect the data into a centralized system. We have access to it to review it and analyze it on our own. We also look to the state to help with that analysis. So the answer, I guess, is both.
Anybody else? Barbara.
I think Mr. Moss was getting at some of my concern, and that is, you know, for people to make their choices now as we begin to reopen, and everybody wants to reopen and get back to normal, whatever that is. But I think people really need a lot of information to be able to assess their risks and so forth. And I'm just wondering if we have that information so that people can follow things. I was just looking at the number of cases in Virginia Beach, and we had the chart that showed through the 7th, we had had 454, and I think you said today we have 517. That's an increase of 63 in 4 days. It seems to be a higher rate than we had been having, which doesn't conform with the 14-day decline. Are we doing more testing in Virginia Beach? Is that part of the reason that we have more cases, or do we know, or do you know how many tests have been done in Virginia Beach and how that's tracking with this?
The number of cases do not kind of increase on a smooth curve. Some of it is related to the outbreaks that we do see a jump, but typically we do kind of see some of the test results come in batches. What we have been doing is going back and seeing and looking at the date of onset, not looking at the date of the test result, and that is a much smoother curve. So there are not significant, or I would say dramatic, increases, but we have seen some jumps related to the outbreaks that we have experienced.
No, I have heard, and I think it's in the governor's briefings, that it's possible to look to see where cases are by zip code. Is there a website or something that we can access that tells us where the cases are by zip code and I guess the contact tracing, what it's revealing?
We We are beginning to look at that more closely at the state level, and that data is beginning to come out. At a local level, we have mapped our cases previously to see if we have any particular hot spots, and we have not seen any. They've been largely scattered throughout the city.
To be able to track it by zip code, and I know I've heard them talking about that. Maybe Mr. Tower has something to offer, I think he's suggesting.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
May I add a comment? The pilot has just released a news story on the zip code information, and it indicates that Virginia Beach has, in the Hampton Roads area, Virginia Beach has 4 zip codes, doesn't say which ones they are, although there's a map you can, it's pretty hard on the small machine to do it. There's a map you can get to it. The story itself doesn't say, but it says we have 4 in the top 10 in Hampton Roads, but only 2 in the top 50 in the state. I think my recollection is from looking at the first zip code map that I saw that 23452 had the most cases. I think that's where Virginia Beach General Hospital is, in, maybe in that. Is that right?
No, that's 5-4.
What's 5-2?
5-2 is Little Neck. Yeah, Kings Grant, Little Neck.
Okay, well,
Princeton Plaza.
5-1 and 5-2 seemed to me to have the largest numbers, but the numbers seemed way out of proportion to the other zip code, so I'm not sure how accurate it was. But anyway, it's now there. There's a link to the map in the article. I'd be happy to send it to everybody.
What is the link? Can we give that to people?
Yeah, I would assume you can, because they're just hooking into something on the, probably on the health department site. Let's see. Yeah, it's on something called datawrapper.dwcdn.net. But I think I'll forward the story to the clerk, and maybe she could distribute it if you, to
that
everyone.
That would be helpful. We can pass it on. Thank you.
Mr. Moss.
The reason why I mentioned about the model and its reliability, because all this data that we have today, none of it's statistically significant. And one of the things they talk about, because it is just testing people that meet certain conditions, as they testified in the testimony today, no one really knows, because the volume of testing and the distribution across testing. So if anything, you should count on that there's underreporting versus overreporting, and that's why trying to draw links about zip codes. And I know when I first, the state was hesitant to put out zip code level data, because they were concerned that people would start drawing conclusions from non-statistically represented data and then drawing prejudicial conclusions from it and then causing issues. Because we just have counting what shows up. But this is not, that's why the volume of testing has to be huge to start drawing links about the patterns that you see. And I just want people to know, so when they see this data, that gets back to Mrs. Henley's point about what can you draw from what you know and how much can you assess from the risk, is that we have to be honest about the reliability of the data set to make forecasts. And that's why I was asking the question, if they were looking forward, is there a model showing when the 14-day trend line should come down? I suspect it's not. And so I think that we're not going to be able to eliminate risk from the data that we see. But we do know what works, we think. But even that is not certain. So I know some states are trying to look. I think California, Ohio are one. We're going to try to go out and do statistical sampling, you know, to kind of see what really the situation is. So just doing 10,000 tests in of itself isn't going to give a statistical significance unless that 10,000 test has some kind of distribution that's random that allows you to see what's happening. So it's, I don't want to give people a false sense of security that when they see these numbers, that they could, that they think they have a foundation to make judgments about different situations, because it's, because we just don't know, and people just need to be overcautious, do what we're doing here and following the rules. But some level of risk will have to be accepted. It's a harsh thing to say to some people, to get the economy rolling, because that is part of life too, and I think the mayor has talked to that. It's just, I think Ms. Henley's right. People just want to know how good the information is, and if it's just our best guess, then it's our best guess. But we shouldn't try to represent it as being, I think that's Dr. Fauci's talk, as being a scientific forecast based upon random sampling, because that is not what has taken place.
Well stated, Mr. Moss. Anybody else?
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Leahy, I think we're ready to move to the next speaker.
Yes, Mayor. Next up would be Aaron Sutton, our Director of Emergency Management.
Welcome, Aaron.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Just a few, excuse me, updates from the city. Dr. Lindsay covered most of the health information. Just a reminder that, as you all are well aware, the governor signed Executive Order 61 that presented a detailed framework for the first phase of Forward Virginia. And between Ron and I, will talk a little bit more about that. He also signed today Executive Order 62, delaying Northern Virginia jurisdictions from entering phase one until midnight on Thursday, May 28th. And he also extended the opening of the DMVs for another week. Just to update you on our city operations, the EOC is maintaining its current COVID-19 response structure, but we're working through the integration into recovery, excuse me, and conducting planning meetings as well for hurricane season. So working through the contingency planning of hurricane and COVID-19. Our logistics team continues to do an outstanding job of getting their hands on PPE. Each week, we are looking at the challenges that we have. While the supply chain is continuing to improve, it's still every person across the country, every state, looking for supplies. We are working very closely with the courts now as they sort through getting back open. And helping to support their needs, as well as working with our voter registrar as she looks at the approaching election in June with 96 polling locations. So working through that as well. Currently, there are around 1,600 remote users in the city on our IT system. And IT also just launched a brand new virtual VPN network to allow additional 10,000 remote users. So it has really increased our capacity to continue to telework. Human Services continues to process the large number of SNAP applications. Our Parks and Rec continue to provide childcare options for city staff and Sentara Healthcare. And they are working towards what childcare or summer camps may look like for us in the months to come. Food distribution continues. And I'd like to take the tail end here to talk about the hard work of our local nonprofit organizations. I believe all of you received a report from the Office of Volunteer Resources, the report on the Hampton Roads Regional Resources Guide and the range of services that they've been providing. These organizations have helped us in past events and continue to support the City of Virginia Beach and the Hampton Roads area, addressing things like feeding operations, volunteer support for food delivery, providing PPE to the city, conducting comfort care check-ins, and several other needs that have come up over the weeks that have passed. 47 of the 63 food pantries in Virginia Beach are currently open. Volunteer Hampton Roads has recruited over 1,400 volunteers for meal prep, who've prepped 86,000 meals and delivered 58,000 meals to those in need. United Way of Southampton Roads is providing capacity and coordinating infrastructure to support their nonprofit partners and providing direct services to individuals through the coronavirus recovery hotline with support from four kids. Four Virginia Beach churches through the Interfaith Alliance at the Beach have partnered with World Central Kitchen and Pharrell Williams to distribute restaurant-made meals. So they've done a tremendous job. I just want to recognize the Red Cross, Faith in Action, Interfaith Alliance at the Beach, Food Bank of Southeastern Virginia and the Eastern Shore, Corona Aid 757, Four Kids, JCOC, Penn Ministry, Salvation Army of Hampton Roads, Senior Services of Southeastern Virginia, Team Rubicon, United Way of Southampton Roads, Virginia Beach Food Pantry, Volunteer Hampton Roads, and many, many others. We couldn't do it without them, and many of them have been with us from Hurricane Matthew to our to May 31st, to hurricanes, to coronavirus, and will be with us back through hurricane season again. So with that, any questions?
Any questions for Aaron? Barbara?
Not a question, but a comment. Aaron has so much on her plate, I don't know how she even sleeps at night. I think when she took that job, she thought she was going to be dealing with hurricanes, and it's been everything but almost, or in addition to. But I want to say how much I admire your adaptability.
Thank you.
Given the fact that we have to remember that flooding is before this was our public enemy number one, and that we had that as our top priority, and with hurricane season, and I know you have been talking about the challenges that we will have if we have a hurricane with the virus and so forth. So I think we really have to start being prepared for that. And this maybe would be an exercise for Public Works more than your department, but both. Would it be possible for us to look at, if we had a Matthew this fall or had Matthew this fall, what would be the differences in the impacts based on the work that's been done since Matthew? Right off the top of the bat, I know that we have cured the problem, I think, for Sherwood Lakes, and that wouldn't have a problem. What other things have been done that would improve the situation? I really think we need to start looking at what has been done. I think a lot has been done, but then also what maybe still is out there to be done. But that might be an interesting exercise for Absolutely. Us to be able to gauge what we've accomplished and what we yet have to do. Don't want to add anything to your plate, but.
We got to talk about hurricane season. I think it'll be an opportunity as maybe in the weeks to come to talk about where we are with hurricane planning.
Well, I'm just a little nervous about the weather because I think they are
as
forecasting an active season, and this has been a very different year with weather as well. And so I think we really have to keep this as a on our plate along with the virus issues.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay, anybody else? Okay, thank you, Aaron.
Just a comment.
Okay, please.
The model that we do have does allow us to show the increased drainage capacity in Princess Anne Plaza, and you actually can model, because they have the rain events, and they can graphically show you what happened with Matthew, and then you can say, program in the requirements because we increased drainage capacity, or to hold the water, and they can show you, if you had the same event, what the level of water flooding would be pre and post the events. You just have to enter the parameter values. I did a look at that about maybe a year and a half ago, I think. I sat down with Public Works just to see what we could see from the model when they program in the improvements, so you can graphically see the difference.
Okay, Mr. Bellucci.
Well, I just want to take a moment to thank Council Member Henley and Council Member Moss for their observations on the storm and flooding concerns. And I do think, I just want to second the request that Ms. Henley made and offer my support to it, that we really get a briefing on that, because I agree with her that we don't want to lose sight of the other challenges that we face, and I know we all agree. We don't want to lose sight of the other challenges that we face. But I also think a briefing like that would help to bring the public up to speed about what they may be facing. with the upcoming storm season and will help them prepare. And I think that's really important, and it's really critical, and it's, you know, we can, what they say, walk and chew gum. So we need to be responding and preparing and recovering from this virus, but also be aware of what other challenges we may face. So I agree, and I'm hopeful we could get that in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bellucci. Anybody else? Thank you, Aaron, and I think there's a lot of us believe what Mrs. Henley said in your kudos is beyond, you're unbelievable. Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Ron and I are going to tag team the next piece. So.
Okay, come on on, Ron. Mr. Leahy?
Mayor, members of council, next up would be Ron Williams, deputy city manager. Although I guess Aaron's going to start, and then Ron's going to pick up. As soon as we bring up the slide deck.
I have it ready. It should be coming out.
Okay. So,
sorry, I'm not sure what's doing something. Yeah, they're doing something.
Yep.
There we go.
So, as I told you in my earlier statements, we're shifting from that response into recovery, and we sent out surveys to all the departments to talk through reintegration, what their concerns were, what their issues were, and so part of that we're going to run through today. The first slide here is just a reminder of kind of what Forward Virginia Phase 1 looks like for us as it was released on Friday. And we will see this happen this coming Friday as we look at all of the areas. But some of the key things for me in looking at city workforce and city operations, the recommendation of teleworking continuing, face coverings continuing with the gatherings of limited to 10 people. Ron is going to touch on several of the others, but I just wanted to put this up here for a reminder as this is what we're looking at moving forward. Based on the reintegration survey that we did, this was kind of the feedback that we saw. It does include... And this was put together before the release of Executive Order 61. But kind of what we were looking at for City of Virginia Beach employees, continuing with teleworking. And we will be working through this and fine-tuning this so that we have a plan to communicate to our city employees. But making sure that we're addressing monitoring of employees, accommodations for vulnerable populations, continuing really staying the course at this point, as several of the council members brought up, the data is what the data is, and we continue to see some increases, but at the end of the day, we want to make sure that what we're doing still provides the services to the city. So as we meet and work through our recovery plan, we will continue to provide that information to you. And so with that, city operations and workforce, we're navigating the reopening of the city, and these were the key issues that really shook out for folks. Obviously, having PPE and barrier protection for our workforce is extremely important, and we don't want to move forward until we have that. And as we continue to wait for orders to come in and continue to work with the supply chain, we want to make sure that we have that in place. Capacity and support for enhanced cleaning as we return. Our building maintenance folks have done an outstanding job, but there's a lot of empty spaces now. And as people start to move back into their spaces, that ability to continue that enhanced cleaning will increase, and we want to make sure that we have that covered as well. Development of a monitoring process for staff and what that looks like. Guidance for public. Once they do come back into city buildings or have interaction with city departments, we want to make sure that they are educated as well. Updating the policies and procedures. We are, as Councilwoman Henley said, normal. I don't think we're going back to normal. I think we're going to a new normal and new policies and procedures that need to be developed. Teleworking has been very successful for many departments. Rotating schedules have worked very well. And so really making sure that we're addressing that as we come in. And then determining priority of opening and what our appropriate timeline looks like for the city of Virginia Beach. And the two big things that was a common theme throughout the over 86 responses that I got from our city departments, return to work doesn't mean that we are abandoning teleworking because we're finding that it is very efficient in several locations. But also returning to work does mean a well thought out plan. Because there's a lot of fear with coming back to work too. And we wanna make sure that it's very well thought out, that we cover all of our bases. So once we have worked through all of these, we provide the recommendations to our city leadership to move forward. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Ron.
Welcome, Ron.
Good evening. Okay, working through these. I'm gonna drop down so I can breathe a little bit. Okay, so as you probably can pick up from some of Aaron's comments, the recovery and understanding guidelines, whether from federal or state, it's a constant moving target. So we've had a recovery work group as part of our overall task force for about a month now. And now, as Aaron said, we're rolling into to a different phase, but this is essentially how we've organized work, multidiscipline team, and we're seeing constant evolution in the programs that are, or the protocols that we're establishing. So quickly walk you through these. The emergency assistance has been some of the forefront of things coming out of as we're looking towards some openings, but of course, you may recall we formed a relationship with the ODU Assistance Center initially to help with people with the SBA loans, and that was an early program. Today, the Development Authority took action on the approval that you gave for EDIP Part E, that you're familiar with the housing assistance funds that we came through, and of course the tax holiday. Today in the budget, you have the public utilities. And we also have looked at what things could stimulate the economy moving forward. And so you had the additional funding for advertising, and we're using that as a key target portion of our economy. We have future EDIP funds that we can continue to assist businesses, perhaps in a different way than we traditionally do. And then we'll be standing up a small business assistance center to make sure that we continue that thread of what was started with the ODU program. I'm going to comment on the CARE Act funding here in another slide in a minute. And then Aaron walked you through some of the different work that's going on with departments for the opening protocols. Again, the greens representing that they're underway, or the yellow is pending, and then the under development. City operations workplace is very much that internal focus, and then the public facilities and venues is that external focus. And we're understanding that some departments have a retail function that we have to work through as well. Beach reopening, I'm gonna walk you through what we talked with the governor about in a minute. So some additional funding assistance. Today we did receive initial notification that the CARES Act local assistance is approximately $64 million for the city. So we'll be working through the eligibility and review of that and bring recommendations. The manager will bring those forward. There is, in part, a reimbursement consideration for some of our COVID-19 emergency, but we also perhaps, as we read through the eligibility, would like to recommend additional assistance similar to the programs that you've already approved.
Well, really quick, you said 64 or
34?
34.
Oh. I'm sorry if I said that. We also have approximately $3.5 million, and this was an update I asked Andy for. You previously approved the new CARES Act funding coming through the HUD programs, but we have previous year, current year, and next year's money that cumulatively come to about $3.5 million that can be allocated also for these housing assistance programs, particularly with the flexibility that the CARES Act provided. Andy's working through 600 applications right now that we initially had for the housing assistance, and he's going to provide a report in the Friday package for you on what we're seeing, what type of applicant data we're seeing in that pool, and a recommendation that we'd like for your consideration for the use of these monies to continue to enhance the pot for the housing assistance. Additional considerations I'd like to recommend this evening for the future would be, as we look at the phase one restrictions that have come out from the governor, we realize that they were not as open for some businesses as we were hoping, or some of the preliminary discussions, and in particular that was for restaurants. The fact that they will be operating phase one still with takeout, but they can do outdoor dining, many of which don't currently have that. And so we'd like to propose a couple things. One is, we have current outdoor cafes that pay franchise fees to the city that have not been able to operate under this emergency order. And so we would ask for consideration to waive those fees. Collectively, it's a little more than $300,000 for the city, but we believe that it is a good faith effort to continue to support the businesses, some of which pay several thousand for that franchise fee for the use of that outdoor space. Secondly, we would like to get creative to support restaurants doing outdoor dining. We have certain ordinances that are very prescriptive on certain areas of the city, such as the resort zoning districts or town center, others which are more open. But what we'd like to do is bring forward an ordinance for your consideration that would allow use of public sidewalks, the boardwalk connector parks and the green belt, and then private parking lots. That may not need to be explicit in the ordinance, but the sentiment is there that we would like to support this activity as much as possible. There's significant conversation going on with ABC and the health department about how this can occur. And of course, we would also always maintain ADA compliance in any sidewalk. Another consideration would be use of parking spaces in the public right-of-way with the parklet program. That's a little more complicated. We'd like to flesh out some guidance on that, but the simple form of use of sidewalks with tables and chairs and the connector parks and parking lots, we certainly hope that we could get some support for consideration of that, and hopefully in time for them to open this weekend. How we would administer that is we would have a more streamlined permit form, similar to the cafe, currently cafe guidelines that we have. The staff is reviewing that now and stripping out some of the more cumbersome build-out aspects of that, and it could be administered through the SGA staff with inspections of the SGA staff for those that are on sidewalks, connector parts, or greenbelt, and then essentially it would be up to the private property owners to manage the parking lot scenarios. I'll pause there for a minute before I get into the beach reopening and see if we have any comments.
Any questions, Mr. Wood?
Well, I was going to save it till the end, but I really think this is a good idea, and I had the opportunity today to talk to a guy who has a small restaurant, not at Town Center, not at the oceanfront, but just kind of right in the middle of the city. And he asked me, you know, when I was in there, he said, when are you guys going to let us open again? And I made abundantly clear that it wasn't us, that it was people up in Richmond that were making that decision. And then I kind of broached the subject with him. I said, well, what would you do if you had this ability? And within a couple of minutes, he had it completely fleshed out in his head how his business would create this new capability in a parking lot and on the sidewalk and all that sort of thing. He said, well, I've never been able to do this before. And I said, well, if we could do this, would that help? And he said, yeah. He told me his business was off 60% from where he was before. And again, small business guy, still paying his rent. And not in one of the targeted areas of Town Center or the oceanfront, somebody who really needs it. So, Mr. Mayor, I'd ask that that we do a special meeting to consider mm-hmm. this stuff. And I think, frankly, for me, it's easy enough that we could do this one virtually and get this stuff done, because I think this is absolutely a no-brainer. I think this is something we should do. I think it's something that's very easy for us to do to help people. It's not going to be long-term. It'll be until we get to whatever that phase is that allows people to go back inside, and at least it gets them to this ability. But I think whatever we do needs to not just focus on Town Center and the resort. It's got to focus on everybody throughout the city, because everybody is impacted by this, and so I think that's what we need to do. So I'd ask Mr. Mayor if the staff can prepare this stuff within a day or two that you know, you call a special meeting so we can just knock it out virtually.
Ryan, before I get to Jessica, so I can piggyback on Jim, yes, we have been talking with the city staff. They're in the process of getting all the legalities and everything together, and I think this should be a high priority for our council, and I think calling a special meeting this week, if we can get these folks open by the weekend, I think would be most helpful. Jessica?
Well, I was just going to say that Councilmember Wood and I are reading from the same sheet of music. I think several weeks ago in my district, there was a restaurant owner that took it upon himself to open his restaurant into the parking lot, and my understanding is it went very well. I also think that's a great opportunity for us to utilize some of our overparked areas, make it more efficient, and hopefully maybe some of the efficiencies created with these temporary programs gets to roll over into whatever new normal looks like, because I do think there's a lot of advantages. I just wanted to be clear, Ron, so this would be for a city, this would be a citywide guideline.
Absolutely. Right.
Okay, and then the other thing, one of the things I'm noticing too in everybody's quest to help their business survive, I'm noticing kind of a tailgate style eating arrangement starting to emerge. At least in my side of the city, I see people will go and they'll get their takeout and then they'll just sit in there. So I don't know if maybe we can try to codify. I think the tailgate idea might be something there as well. So I'm in big support of this. So I'm glad to see that it sounds like we're probably going to move in that direction.
Mr. Wood.
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up on one thing. I think it's important for the viewing public at least to understand that the way that parking is determined on in shopping centers and things like that is based on occupancy of restaurants.
Right.
And right now the restaurant occupancy is zero. And so there is available parking to create these spaces. And I think that's great. As long as nobody's in the building, it doesn't impact the parking for the rest of the shopping center and that sort of thing. So I think that's an important thing that people need to realize. We're not talking about, you know, creating a disparate problem for other shoppers and other businesses that are open. You know, say if there's a grocery store that's open next to a sub shop or something, we need to make sure that they're both covered. But I think the way this works is they certainly are.
And Mr. Stiles, it's been a significant amount of time, you know, looking for what parameters we have that we would need to ask you to, you know, lessen or repeal. And so the ordinance is likely narrowly focused because there's restrictions in our ordinances, whereas parking lots right now, we essentially could do administratively, as I understand that, Mr. Stiles, through the zoning ordinance. So when you see the ordinance and the language, don't be surprised if it's only talking about a couple areas, but it's intended to be a citywide opportunity.
Great. Michael.
Thank you, Mr. Williams, for your work on this, and I think it's very exciting. I think it will be very helpful. I wonder if you could speak a little bit more about you mentioned parklets, mm-hmm. and because one of the things I've been hearing is actually from several different folks today and also yesterday was a very popular program that I guess has received a lot of media attention in a Florida city using city streets. And I don't know if that's what you meant by parklet or if you could just expand further. I understand fully the concept of using shopping center parking lots and that makes sense. But I wonder if you could just expand further upon the city infrastructure.
Sure.
Side.
So, and I apologize for not having an image in this presentation of a parklet. I happened to stand up a parklet program in a neighboring city in 2015. I will share those guidelines in the Friday package if you'd like to see that. It has been done throughout the United States where you essentially take a parking space, usually 8x22 or 8x20, and you put a structure that allows an opportunity either casually for someone to just enjoy the space, or it may be associated with a restaurant. One of the challenges that here in Virginia we've had is the distance between a restaurant and the use of them and ABC restrictions. So they haven't taken off as much with having that interaction with the restaurant. It is more challenging because you want to make sure that you are diminishing the liability and that you're having a safe environment for someone to sit in. But I'll share those guidelines with you so you can get a flavor of it. It is a request coming from a couple of the business associations for consideration, and we certainly could probably work through a pilot program. Again, just making sure we do it purposeful that people would be safe doing it.
Well, and just a follow-up, I think they've been very popular in other communities, especially communities with the type of hospitality culture like we have.
Yeah.
And I think they represent an innovation that's very popular with locals and with visitors. And it may be part of, as we talk about a new normal, it may be part of what new normal looks like for us. And it creates kind of a dynamic culture as well as providing access to, to operate for businesses during this time. So I think it's really exciting and I appreciate it very much.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Moss.
I've always said he who regulates least regulates best. And leaving the free market to itself, they'll better solve problems than we do at less cost. And I think this demonstrates that when our revenues are in jeopardy because businesses can't produce, we're much more inclined to let the free market work. And I hope that sticks. I hope that attitude sticks after this is over, that we've learned that the free market is much better at regulating and interacting with the customers with market effective solutions than the ones we generally come up with trying to protect ourselves. And I hope that philosophy carries over, as Jessica pointed out, as we come out of this, that we don't lose those insights that work so effectively now, they'll work effectively after now. So I hope we can capitalize on that, Mr. Mayor, make a lot of those things permanent.
Well stated, Mr. Moss. Mr. Tower.
I'd just like to add a couple of things. In my discussions with folks in the restaurant industry, particularly the Restaurant Association, there are two issues that have arisen. Of course, the main issue, overriding issue, is being essentially closed for any kind of indoor or outdoor dining just for takeout. And improving that was a big goal. And the improvement happened to be to have some outdoor dining. And of course, some restaurants are very well situated for that, but others are not. So it there's a sense of fairness to different businesses. And this is a way for us to kind of level the playing field for all the restaurants. Not everyone will have an opportunity do outdoors, but it greatly expands the number of restaurants that can take advantage of the current governor's executive order. And I want to say also that the association has expressed to me their particular appreciation for Mr. Williams and Mr. Stiles are really jumping on this and moving it forward. They're very grateful and very excited about the prospect of being able to serve more customers. You know, the restaurant industry feels they are the most regulated in terms of cleanliness and health of any industry that we have, and yet they are not the first to open and the last. So they're frustrated in a way, as they think they are experts in health and safety, and I think they're right. And they know how to run a safe and operate a safe place. But this is a great opportunity to give them a break, and I join in the cheering on, hoping some of these regulations may last beyond the COVID period, because some of them have always puzzled me as to how efficacious they were in really preventing abuses of alcohol or whatever other safety and health reasons were. Particularly as you travel around the United States and to other resort areas, and you see a number of setups in other states that seem to be more accommodating to what people really enjoy doing for outdoor dining. Thanks.
Anybody else? Rosemary.
tough as all of this has been, I think that there will be some good things that will come out of it, and ways of life that will change, that will stick with us. And, you know, we will adapt to some of these new things, like you talked about some more people who may be teleworking at home, and, you know, this thing with the restaurants, and there's some silver linings to some of the things that are happening. So I think this will be one of them.
Okay. Anybody else? Well, I agree with Rosemary and John Moss. Let's make life easier for folks, and let's keep it going. And let's keep council members, if we could be at the ready to, you know, come forward, you know, when things are ready to move forward. I think this has got to be a high priority this week. Mr. Leahy.
So we'll direct staff to move forward with preparation of the ordinances for your consideration, and you'll schedule a special meeting.
ASAP, yes. Okay, thank you. Mr. Stiles.
It would be my anticipation and hope that we would have an ordinance ready to circulate among council electronically sometime tomorrow, and therefore you could have a special meeting on Thursday. If you want to discuss now at what time you would want to have that meeting, that would be...
Would 3 o'clock on Thursday be convenient to folks? Mm-hmm. Or later?
We're talking about virtual meeting.
We could do virtual too, correct?
Is that good for you, Jessica? I know you work like I do. Does that work for you? We make it 4.
Before? Would 4 o'clock
four
be good?
Would be better. Thank you, Mr.
Okay.
Mayor.
How about 4 o'clock on Thursday? Okay. Thank you all. Is that okay?
I think it'd be Jessica.
You were in agreement? Okay. Thank you. 4 o'clock on Thursday.
Okay. Okay. Mayor, answered questions and walked you through some of the framework of the reopening. You have a copy of the reopening plan, the beach plan.
If we could discuss that is another high priority.
Okay, and so I'm not going to read every word. I'm going to kind of take us through this and then stand by for questions. This came about when we were made aware that there was consternation about the opening of the beaches, and that the governor needed to understand that there was a safe way to open it. And so... So working with a collaborative team, internal and external, we recommended this plan largely based on 4 key pillars. I'm going to get to that in a minute. But what we emphasize with the governor is to understand that the asset of our beaches are not just for Virginia Beach, but they're for the Commonwealth, and not only for the economy, but also for the mental health of our residents. And it's a really great place for people to recharge and refresh in light of everything that's been going on. And so the 4 pillars of what we would recommend in phase 1 is that we have cleaning, distancing, education, and enforcement. And so we would, the strategies to implement this would be to divide the oceanfront, bayfront, Croatan and Sandbridge beaches into manageable zones, that we would have areas of engagement and enforcement, that we would deploy clean teams. And here's the key, and that is beach ambassadors, and I'll walk us through that in a minute, and that to reinforce what we're trying to do here, that we would have collateral educational materials. So the zones are here. There's some not pictured, but basically we divide that up, and teams would be assigned to that. And the types of engagement we would have, where we have the more dense activity or parking lots, such as Little Island down in Sandbridge or the oceanfront boardwalk area, we would have teams at every access. In the Bayfront, North End, and Croatan beaches, we would have a roving patrol similar to how we do lifeguards now. The cleaning, we really thought about this, and this is another moving target. And we're using the word cleaning, not disinfecting right now, and we're looking at what actually works. It's an outdoor environment. If you look at the WHO or CDC guidelines, this is one of the lowest risk areas that you can have anyone gathering in. But we did establish a protocol that we recommend that we have clean teams that are assigned to a 5-block area, 2-person teams, and they'll work around the clock. And they'll look at those high-touch surfaces, such as the railings that go down the access, the water fountains and foot washes, the crosswalk buttons, and then the magazine bins. We also would power wash the other accesses on the other beaches on a more frequent basis than we do now. We've thought through what type of materials they would need and what their schedules would be. And so that is actually a part of a team that's being stood up now. We had, as you know, a short RFP. We have I Am Going as our vendor that's going to provide these services. And so the clean team members are starting to be hired now. And again, we're having conversations with the health department about what protocols we actually should be using. They don't really exist right now. Distancing is key in order for us to advocate that we can have a safe beach environment. And so they will be required to practice physical distancing, and we're recommending at the 6 foot, like universally being used right now, unless you're family members, groups of no more than 10 beachgoers. And we will help mitigate the potential for surges in density by, during phase one, having no more than 50% occupancy of our parking garages. And when and if necessary, we can suppress that down if we start to see some increase in density. Additionally, we would like to continue the on-street parking on Atlantic Avenue, predominantly because we do not want to run the trolley this summer. It is a moving mass gathering. And so this would give us the opportunity to continue the use of that. It also would act somewhat as an economic stimulant for the businesses down there by having the parking right in front of them, which we have seen benefits from that in the winter, the past two seasons of that activity on Atlantic Avenue. But again, if it helps us further disperse the crowds. We would have no entertainment, no programming, or anything that would generate a mass gathering during phase one, and it could potentially last into phase two as well. And the place that's on the beach would remain closed. So our educational collateral, we have a laundry list here, but this is an example of one of the 70 signs that we would have in between the accesses, and then we have our 40 access boxes. The type of material that we would be deploying here is reminding people to please do your part, help stop the spread, and what are the rules on the beach? That right there on the right is an example of the poster size that go in the boxes at every access, and we will have that. The colors are evolving on this because we understand certain colors fade faster than others when they're out there for more than a week, and so that we're working through that. But again, keep the distance, limit the groups, and we're also working on some images for PPE to be included. Our ambassadors would reflect this. This image and reminding everyone of their presence, because the ambassador's role is really comes in with the enforcement. They are the frontline friendly reminder for everyone to keep their distance in order for us to continue to have the privilege, if the governor grants it, for us to have an open beach. And what do we mean by open beach in this phase, probably phase one and two? It's basically the ability to sit down. We don't have that currently unless you're fishing. And so that's the key thing we've asked the governor. As governor, we would like the ability for people to sit down. So there'll be that constant reminder on the and every access will have an ambassador on the beach and an ambassador on the boardwalk, and then the clean team working the accesses. They'll approach if someone's not physically distancing, or if they see a group gathering of more than 10, they'll approach and ask for voluntary compliance. And when they don't receive that, then they have the ability to call through into the different precinct commands to get a response of the police, who will also be patrolling. Public safety will also be monitoring by overhead on drones, their normal patrols, overhead camera integration, and the marine boat patrols. And ultimately, if overcrowding occurs, we have two measures. One is, I have on here, we can initiate temporary closures of the beach and close it. We also can eliminate further traffic from coming in, like we do on the large weekends of College Beach Week or 4th of July, and we might have to turn traffic away from time to time. The ambassadors will also be that eyes on the beach, along with public safety, for seeing when we're starting to get density, like we see where we have parking garages and parking lots and feeding back to the parking system. We need you to suppress parking for a couple hours so that we can start to get some spreading. We've talked through today with the governor's office, even about some ideas of how we implement this. This was an image that I shared with them just on the interoperability and what's different now. That's what they really wanted to know. What's different now? Well, we have significant signage and education. We have the yellow shirts that are integrating out on the beach and interacting with the beachgoers, and then we're integrated with public safety. And the timeline, we already started. We're hiring up, we're advertising. and we're starting to get the educational materials printed. We'll be training this weekend, predominantly with the supervisors and any other ambassadors or clean team that were able to be hired this week. And we delivered the message that we can execute Memorial Weekend. If we were given the opportunity to open this weekend, we would be doing it predominantly with the skeleton ambassador crew and public safety for the enforcement. But we are ready for that if given that opportunity. The governor has assigned Secretary of Natural Resources Matt Strickler as the key point for determining whether or not beaches can open and make the recommendation. We spent an hour today walking through the plan again. We're going to spend another hour tomorrow with our integrated team answering some more questions and establishing a little further protocols on this, some ideas that were passed around today, and Dr. Lindsay was on that call making some recommendations, including, you know, some of the activities in the parking garage at elevators or other touch places or other considerations that could prevent people from being tempted to have gatherings. It is a high bar, we realize that, but we don't know of any other locality other than one in Florida that is doing a similar program. We want to not only encourage the governor to, you know, to trust that we can have this safe environment, but we want it for our visitors that Virginia Beach has the gold standard, that we're open and that we have the ability to give them a good place to recreate.
Before we take some questions, I just want to thank you all for the hard work you put in. As a matter of fact, the governor did give us a bit of a shout out during his press conference last Friday, and we did acknowledge we do have a plan, and right now it's just the idea to execute it and just convince them that we are ready to go. And I just want to thank you all for your efforts. Any other questions or comments? John,
and then Jess. The one I didn't touch upon was, what's our plan for the public restrooms?
Right.
When I hear the people on TV for Hilton or people with airlines, this has been the number one challenge, is the public restrooms. So, and what is our plan for that?
So we have a vendor that it's under contract, and they've already been walking us through their new protocols. They're higher, they are in a disinfecting environment, they actually are sharing some of their recommended best practices for what we're doing on the exterior as well.
All right, one of the things we're considering is the use of ultraviolet light. You can close the place down because that is a means of disinfecting and killing the virus, is ultraviolet light. That's what they use in the HVAC systems in hospitals.
Great question. I'm not sure, but we'll inquire about that.
And I think that's what people, we're trying to convince people publicly, just what is the cleaning regimen? Because I know that's what I hear from the,
yes.
When you hear the people on TV talk about their industry, they talk a lot about their protocol for that. So
yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Barbara.
You seem to be addressing the oceanfront an awful lot, which is fine. That's where it's supposed to be. But then we have zones for the other beaches as well. And I'm thinking, of course, of Sandbridge and the situations that occurred there in March before things got closed, you know, with the traffic and the difficulty in parking and such a long beach in a residential area. Do you have different plans for the residential areas?
Yes, ma'am. And it's not on the screen, so if you take a... draw your attention to slide number 13. This is where we describe where we'll have the roaming beach ambassadors. At Little Island, we know that we'll have somewhere between 4 and 6 ambassadors at the pier and those 4 accesses that are those accesses. And then between Dam Neck and the pier, and then south of the pier, we'll have roving that is also augmented by public safety and the lifeguards as well. Now, the lifeguards will not be asked to engage in any conversation about voluntary compliance for physical distancing because they need to remain in a life-saving mode. But they are also mic'd up and connected with the communication system. And so there'll be constant roving on that. What happened in March is we don't have as many personnel on the beach at that time of year in any capacity. And so we will have more bodies on the beach, but they're not going to, realistically, in those wide open spaces, the more residential areas, we're not going to have someone standing at every access because the density isn't there. When we see, start to see gatherings, that's when we'll surge with more public safety that's called in from, and it's three different precincts that we work in, by the way, Bayfront, Ocean, Resort, and Sandbridge. And so each precinct is aware of these protocols that, they'll be training our vendor on and how to make sure they get that surge to come in.
Well, if you were thinking about controlling the crowds on the beach by controlling the parking lots to 50% or some such, what I'm foreseeing is a lot more people trying to go down there, and those parking lots are going to be full, and then people are not going to be knowing what to do, and it's going to be a mess. So, I mean, we've had experience with the parking lots getting too full, even when we were filling them all the way up, but at a lesser amount. So
right.
We're going to have to do a lot of really working with people to know what's going to be expected and what's going to be allowed, and
indeed,
how you're going to be able to control it.
And at some times we may have to say we're closed.
But
ultimately,
if people are on the road going down there,
right,
what in the world do you do with those folks?
Message boards, right.
You're going to have those electronic
all
message
the way back
boards
to
up
Man. Yes, ma'am.
On General Booth.
Right.
Okay, I've got Jim, Jessica, Aaron, and then Rosemary.
So, Ron, when you talked about the roving ones in the non-resort area, are they going to be in vehicles, four-wheel drive vehicles?
We're still working through that. With the public safety team.
Yeah, because that's an issue in and of itself, having experienced people driving.
Yep.
And then that kind of leads me to the other thing, realizing that they're not public safety people, but they're going to be engaging with the public. You know, how are they going to communicate with them? I mean, I know we don't have enough public safety radios to go around for all those people. And those are like $3,500 a pop, so.
The ambassadors will communicate with their supervisors. Their supervisor will communicate with the precinct command.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the supervisors will have access.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Jessica, then Aaron.
I had a question about specifically how the ambassadors will be determining whether or not, this is a question I got yesterday, which I know I reached out to you and Tom about it, about how the ambassadors will determine whether or not something constitutes a family unit. I mean, I assume that's going to be worked out through training. Mm-hmm. Okay.
A little bit of trial and error, too.
Okay.
I mean, so they'll ask, or, you know, are you family members?
Okay.
If not, we'd ask you that, you know, please sit 6 feet apart. Yeah.
I support the plan moving forward. I just think I know there's going to be some, I've heard from people that there's some concerns. And then the other question is not related to the beaches, but where are we at on opening our public parks? That's a question I'm getting asked constantly. Are we thinking about bringing on our public parks at the same time we bring on the beach? There's, you know, obviously there's a whole other side of the city has got city amenities and how we're going to be handling that. Has that been worked out at all?
We'll spend a significant amount of time on that on Thursday. You know, the governor closed our beaches.
Mm-hmm.
And so we want to make sure we're working through the complementary protocols for anything that we have in our own purview. Yes. And the education campaign that you see in here is meant to be dispersed citywide with similar guidelines. You know, we can't have more than 10 people gathering in any of our spaces in the open space in phase one, whether it's federal or state guidelines right now. You know, we want people to be spacing. We want to encourage PPE when you're close to each other. So yes, we have work to do, but that's going to be fleshed out in large part our framework on a lot of that this week.
Okay, thank you.
Aaron and Rosemary.
Thanks, Ron. When is the signage, when are we expected the signage to go up throughout the throughout our city?
Well, right now, you know, our primary focus with this is to try to get us over that hurdle of the beach being closed, or the beach being only open for exercise. And so our first wave, and so that we can start to show Secretary Strickler, because he's going to want to see some of our protocols, the first wave of this will start to come out this weekend.
So we should expect the signage up this weekend?
At least in the poster boxes.
Okay.
At the access points.
And because that ties into my concern for messaging the public and before they actually come down here. I know we're expecting very nice weather this weekend. And so I'd imagine, you know, Secretary Strickler, as well as a lot of eyes will be on the oceanfront and how we are handling, you know, the people that are coming down here and the guidelines and protocols that are already in place. And so my concern and question is, how are we prepared for this weekend, and what is the message and how are we conveying that message to, you know, potential visitors on what's already in place? I think that's going to make a huge difference in getting our beaches open a lot sooner.
So unfortunately, we haven't been able to communicate that we are open, but we are in the mode and are prepared to enforce the executive orders as they are. The Smart Savvy Safe poster that you see there, those essentially still, those requirements, so to speak, still adhere to the exercising environment. People might be exercising, but they can't be in a group of 10 or more, and we would like to see the physical distancing, you know, six or more. So this gives us a warm-up of starting to see the type of language that hopefully Memorial Day and summertime brings us.
I think we, Mr. Mayor, if we could, I think it would be, you know, a smart move on our part to be proactive with the messaging, particularly this weekend with the weather being that it's going to be, you know, 80-something degrees, really nice. Start a messaging campaign right now, right away, to get that out there of what are the guidelines that are already in place. I can't stress enough how big of a weekend this is for us. Will be to getting closer to opening the beaches in a responsible way and gaining that confidence of Secretary Strickland, those at state, to be able to give us the authority and to open up our beaches. So I think we should, you know, that plan that I know we're shooting for Memorial Day, and I know, I think you mentioned earlier, you know, we have certain plans in place to handle crowds this weekend, but I think we should communicate that more effectively and get that out there and ramp up, you know, whether we have to lean heavy again on our finest here, on our patrol officers, but we should lean a lot more heavily this weekend and really show the state that we can handle the crowds that are coming down here, and we're in a position to really enforce, you know, the protocols that we say we can enforce prior to Memorial Day weekend. Thank you.
Yeah, that being said, Ron, are we going to have any of the diplomats ready to get out at all? Are we going to be able to get a few of those folks out to help maybe?
Yes, sir. Realistically, we'll have most of the supervisors trained and working through protocols with public safety throughout the weekend.
Yeah, because, you know, without question, the good weather is going to bring people out, and people have been confined for quite a while. So let's do be ready as much as we can. Rosemary?
Thank you. Fantastic job. I mean, it is, you guys really worked hard. It's very complete, very thorough, and it looks like you've thought of so many things. Has the governor's office given you any input of where they think any holes are, of anything else that you haven't done that or we should be doing that they would like to see us do?
Well, first of all, I do also have to compliment our vendor, I Am Going, Ken McDonald and Eve Cohen there. They really helped us think outside the box and push on it. And the whole public safety team had really jumped to help us establish an integrated team and the protocols that we're working through, and with guidance of the city attorney's office. There's been a lot of questions and a lot of additional suggestions that we are working through. For example, we talked through one this afternoon. You know, what things make people gather? And so, you know, we had to spitball that for about 5 or 10 minutes, and one of which is the, you know, the tailgate type tents. We probably have to say no tailgate tents on the beaches, individual umbrellas only, things of that nature. We have to really push the envelope on thinking through, you know, they were asking what, you know, should we say no to coolers? Should we say no to, you know, music boxes, so on and so forth. So we're gonna continue to evolve it with them this week. What they really wanna see is confidence from the health department and confidence in our ability to actually carry out the plan.
So. I do agree with Aaron that this weekend is gonna be a key weekend because They're going to come. People are going to come. We're going to be challenged. The warm weather and how we handle it's going to be really important, because they're going to be watching to see what we do and how we deal with it, especially if we're supposed to be closed. So when people are on the beach and they don't have a fishing pole, how are we going to deal with that?
Well, we have been, we've had visitors. We have people that are actually staying in hotels now, and public safety has been, you know, doing their part to make sure people are exercising. So, moving along.
Okay, that's good. And have we, I've heard we've been giving some summons. Do you have any idea how many people have been given a summons?
Very few.
We've had a lot of compliance when people have been engaged.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for the great job y'all have all done. Really, it's very impressive.
Yeah, they don't want that. Anybody else? Michael.
Just to follow up on Councilmember Wilson's questions about the summons, I wonder if Mr. Cover, because I see Mr. Cover's here, if he could speak about the impact these plans would have on public safety professionals and also the experience that police, fire, and EMS professionals have had over the last few months, and you know what the landscape looks like for them in the coming months and as we move into recovery as well. These are changing conditions. We rely very heavily on public safety professionals, not only to keep us safe, but to keep things in order. And we're potentially, they're public servants and they do a great job, but just wonder if you could share any updates and thoughts about that, what that looks like.
Certainly. Thank you, Mayor, members of council. So we are really stressing the voluntary compliance component of enforcement. We are going to do a pretty intense training program with the ambassadors that DCM Williams spoke of to make sure that those individuals understand how to gain that voluntary compliance, how to de-escalate some techniques to de-escalate potentially volatile situations, and then if necessary, utilize the communications that we'll have set up to be able to summon an officer there should they need it. So our police officers and our public safety professionals in this city are very adept at dealing with crowds. I think we've proven that over the past several years, many years. A lot of training, a lot of other communities get our officers and our experts in their cities to explain how we do business. So we are prepared. We will up staff. We will monitor, and we will make sure that we keep a safe and friendly environment for our citizens and visitors. That's what we're charged with doing. We are fair, firm, and friendly. That's what we try to be as we as we work through the process.
How would you say that this virus and pandemic has impacted the workforce, public safety workforce? What impacts has this experience had on those men and women?
So just as everyone else has had to do, we've had to flex in public safety in how we deal with these situations. Everything from the time the call comes in to our communication center, we do a set of screening questions that we try to understand what type of potential hazards are there that our people are going to go into. Obviously, with the personal protective gear, we up staff that. A lot of our personnel that are not in the actual operations section, we're pulling them into that to be able to provide some relief there. As we move into the reintegration and the reopening phase, you know, we'll have to put fire marshals back in their offices, fire inspectors back doing their jobs, so they will be pulled off the street, for example. But for the most part, we have adapted well, and that's what, public safety providers are trained to adapt to rapidly changing situations, and they're really good at it. So I don't know if that gives you any more comfort level.
Well, it gives me great comfort, and I just want to thank you and your colleagues and all the men and women who work in public safety for rising to the challenge and for continuing to make sure that we're safe and secure and can move forward with plans like this with great confidence. Thank you.
Well, the support that we get, certainly back at you for our city council, the training, the equipment, the personnel that apply that training and equipment. But we wouldn't be able to do that if it wasn't for the support that we get, not only from our city council, but our citizens. So we do appreciate that.
Thanks.
Yeah. Anybody else at this point? Okay, thank you all for your very hard work with this. You know, we still have a ways to go, but you are really helping us get there quickly and effectively. And Mr. Leahy, next.
So, Mayor and members of council, next up would be our Director of Human Resources, Regina Hilliard, and she will talk to you a little bit about the questions you asked her to investigate last meeting on the city manager search update.
Welcome, Regina.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. At the last meeting, you asked that we make contact with all of the city manager candidates to see if they would be willing to travel to the city to conduct interviews. So the consultant did have that conversation with each of the candidates, and they all expressed still excitement at the opportunity. They are still looking forward to having the opportunity to interview. And they all said that they would be willing to travel to make that happen as well. The only reservation was whether or not they would actually be able to get the flights that they needed. But outside of that, they said that they would be willing to make that happen. Also, last week while we were talking, there were some questions about if we did have to conduct the interviews virtually, or if we chose to conduct them virtually, are we comfortable with the security that we have? I did speak with our IT department to get a feel for how they felt about the security. And of course, they were very strongly emphasizing that we do have a secure platform. They said that when they chose our platform, they chose that primarily because of the security aspects that they knew that we would have to abide by. Their wording was that it provides end-to-end protection in all audio, video, and shared content sessions. So they feel as if we meet the security aspects related to virtual conferencing as well. So I wanted you to have that information so that, you know, you could make the decision as to how we're going to proceed.
Okay, but they all are willing to come.
They are all willing to come, yes.
Okay, and okay, we'll open up for discussion. John?
Well, I'm glad they're willing to come because I think that as good as technology is, it's in this particular position, it's no substitute to having a personal interaction among ourselves and with them. And what I always say about someone's system is secure till it isn't. So when someone says their platform is secure, I always ask them, what is the platform and what do independent people rate it? Because all those things are rated by people who are known to hack. And anyone who's truthful will tell you that no system is hack-proof. That's just, they don't exist. And so I would be interested if we go that route to know what our platform is and what do independent parties who assess providers of platforms say about that relative to other platforms. All platforms have vulnerabilities, and we just need to consciously know what those are. Right. That doesn't mean I don't trust the assessment that we got, but the marketplace has many, many platforms because many people make advertisement authentications about their platform that later prove not to be true. So if we go that way, which I hope we don't, Mr. Mayor, I would still like to have more than, you know, an independent confirmation about just what the vulnerabilities of the system or how it's ranked relative to others, because I do think that's important, and you can't self-assess your own system. That's just not how things work.
Well, I did ask, just in case there were other questions, I did ask to have a representative from IT available here. So if you'd like to speak to any of that, Kevin Fairley is here.
Good afternoon.
So the system that we use is also the same system that we use for city telephony, city networking. It is encrypted end-to-end, and you can invite members to participate. And with a password protection on that invitation, even if they were to forward that information to another user, they would not be able to join that conversation. Now, just to be clear, with web collaboration material, you can certainly see what the camera sees. You cannot see what the camera does not see. So that would be, that's really not a system security item. That is a end user security item. So again, the system provides the security at default. You don't have to opt in or out or make any security selections. They are provided with the platform. End-to-end encryption. And if you had the concern about individual phone line use, you can have the system call you, and then that voice over IP traffic would be encrypted. That phone call from the other end would be encrypted as well. We do have security white papers that certainly can be shared with the platform. And it is one of the, I would say, market leaders as assessed by Gartner, which is an international IT consultancy company.
Any other questions? Any other comments from council? Aaron.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think, you know, Regina, thank you again.
Microphone. Regina, thank you again for getting that information from the candidates. I think the words you used were they were all excited to move forward. I would ask for council, we would be just as excited to move forward and get this process moving forward and start, you know, finding some dates so we can start getting these candidates in. Not speaking for our acting city manager who's been doing a superb job, but I'm sure he would have no objections to us getting along and finding a city manager. And so I would really like to know the thoughts of council to find, you know, find some dates going forward, and whether, because I know we probably have to call a special session or whether that would be, but find dates to move forward to start interviewing these candidates. Thank you.
And if I could suggest that it would be behoove us now, since we are bringing them in, if we could make an arrangement to all be in the same room together. And this way, when we have the interviews and get the gap time, we would all have the ability to interact between. Mr. Ward.
Mayor, I think the city clerk could have something to say about that.
I'm happy to poll council, just as we did last time, for just, if I just have some lead time on available dates, I can poll council and get back with the Regina, and she can let the consultant know.
Yeah, yes, we'll move forward. Yes, Aaron.
I think it would be good for us to also to identify where we would conduct these interviews at, so council will know whether we do it at a school, or building 19 or wherever around the city. It'd be good to identify a location as well.
Right, it would be an executive session. And yes, Mr. Leahy? Well,
we certainly would let council know the location, but we probably don't want to announce that to the public. And the staff and I will make sure that it's this location we pick is room for plenty of social distancing for council and the candidates, but we wouldn't want to announce where that is, otherwise you might have TV trucks parked outside the building.
Yeah, one of the things, we have to protect the privacy of the individuals, you know, that are going to be coming in, and that's of paramount importance. But obviously, I concur. It is time to definitely move aggressively forward, and let's try to get that as done expeditiously as possible.
We are working on it now. We just wanted to make sure of which direction you want it to go. And we're looking at facilities, we're looking at timing. So we will be in contact with you on all of that.
Okay, thank you. Then we are in agreement. Okay, moving forward. Okay, we'll move now forward to ordinances resolution. At this time, and may I ask the Vice Mayor to go ahead and read in the reconciled proposal and, you know, make a recommendation.
Mr. Mayor, I move approval of the following ordinance and resolution. Item A, FY 2020-2021 Resource Management Plan Reconciled Proposal, FY 2020-2021 Operating Budget. One, ordinance to appropriate $2,903,705,923, consisting of $590,252,110 interfund transfers, $227,393,881 for internal service funds, and $2,086,059,932 for operations for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2020 and ending June 30th, 2021. Two, ordinance to establish a tax levy of $1.01 and 75 cents on each $100 of assessed valuation on real estate for FY 2021. Three, ordinance to establish a tax levy on personal property, machinery, and tools for calendar year 2021. Four, ordinance to dissolve the Sandbridge Tax Increment Financing Fund and transfer lapse funds to the general fund. Five, ordinance to authorize the city manager to submit an annual funding plan to the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. Six, ordinance to amend the city code sections 35-64 and 35-67, re exemption or deferral of real estate taxes for elderly or disabled persons. Seven, resolution to amend the City of Virginia Beach Human Resources Policy, re part-time accumulated leave and full-time paid time off. Eight, ordinance to amend city code section 32.5-2, re equivalent residential unit fee. B, FY 2020-2021 capital budget. One, ordinance to adopt the FY 2021-FY 2026 capital improvement program and appropriate $320,558,159 re FY 2021 capital budget, subject to funds being provided from various sources set forth. Two, ordinance to authorize the issuance of general obligation public improvement bonds in the maximum amount of $69,741,841 re various public facilities and general improvements. Three, ordinance to authorize the issuance of stormwater utility revenue system revenue bonds in the maximum amount of $34,708,495. Four, ordinance to authorize the issuance of water and sewer system revenue bonds in the maximum amount of $1,318,515. C, FY 2019-2020 Taxpayers and Businesses Relief and Assistance. One, ordinance to appropriate and transfer $2 million from the FY 2019-2020 Parks and Recreation Operating Budget to the Department of Human Services for taxpayer relief, re COVID-19 impacts. Two, ordinance to appropriate and transfer $1 million from the FY 2019-2020 Parks and Recreation Operating Budget to CIP 9-067 Economic Development Investment Program 2, re assistance to small businesses. Three, ordinance to extend the dates of the real estate tax appeal. So moved, Mr. Mayor.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, discussion, please. Ms. Henley.
I'm going to vote for the budget because I've never voted against a budget, but I'm very much concerned that what we're doing is impacting our ability to deal with stormwater and flooding. This will, of course, increase our 15-year plan. I guess now we're up to 17 years because this will be twice that we've done it. I think it's short-sighted, and unfortunately, I think we're going to be paying a heavy price because in years 2 through 5 of the stormwater CIP, we're going to be cutting some major individual stormwater projects that are not going to be popular to cut. And I was hoping we were going to be able to fully address what we had planned, but unfortunately we're not. And like I say, I'm going to say I'm disappointed that we're doing this, but I understand that we have to start someplace and we have to have a budget, but I just wanted to go on record saying it's this portion of, I guess, item 8 that I wish we weren't doing.
Rosemary?
I'm like Barbara, I'm going to vote for the budget because we have to have a vote, budget, and I've never voted against it. But we do have employees that are concerned that they may not have a job this year, that there's going to be some cuts going forward, and those cuts may be their jobs. So I've said, as far as I know, that will not happen. So I hope that's the case. So I just wanted to go on the record for saying that.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, John.
I have voted against budgets in the past, as people know. I am voting for this budget. There's a lot of tough choices in this budget, and I hope the revenues hold true, because if they don't, we'll have some bigger tough choices. But I think it's important to note that while in this budget, because of how we balanced it with the flooding project, there are out-year cuts. But those cuts don't become a reality unless in next year's budget process we don't fill that gap. I think this council has the creative talent, and I think the staff does as well, to fill those gaps. No one's been a stronger advocate on this council than myself about flooding. It's unfortunate that COVID-19 and the economy overcame our ability to have an aggressive bond referendum, which I was really in favor of when the economy looked better. There will come a time when we'll still need to do that. That's, you know, this is an event we're going to manage. But I think this tried to find the point of the least amount of friction and the least amount of pain, betting that we'll have strong revenue forecast. And I like the fact that the council has acknowledged that probably in October, that's probably not like the General Assembly, when we're going to have a good feel for whether or not those revenues are going to come to fruition, and whether or not the federal government is going to provide some kind of relief, which might make up for those shortfalls. So I think everyone here has something about the budget they like. I think everybody here has something about the budget they don't like. That probably means it's probably close to perfect of the three bears story of the porridge. But I do think it's been a lot of hard work. I would like the tax to be at the lower rate. We didn't get there. I accept that. But I do think the stormwater management fee is a very regressive fee. It has a lot of impact that gets passed through to people at the low end of the income spectrum. So I think that was a good faith effort. And we basically have balanced it by positions that aren't filled. And I don't think we haven't taken enough credit that we took the action to compensate some of the formula reduction on the school system, because they've told us in many a session across the street about how they're behind on the maintaining and modernizing their elementary, middle, and high schools. And this council put $7.7 million back in for that specific purpose, and did not apply the full reduction of what the funding formula would do. So I think that does show this council's commitment to dealing with the facility shortfall that the school board has identified in the past. And that took a lot of hard work. And we did all that balancing on the city side of the ledger. So I think that does demonstrate the strong commitment that we have to public education. I think we did, under the circumstances, a very great, one of the best jobs I've seen in the 17 years I've served. This has been a lot of hard choices, but a good outcome, in my opinion.
Thank you. Mr. Bellucci.
Well, thank you. I'm planning to support the budget. We all know this pandemic has been unlike anything that we've seen in Virginia Beach. And for the purposes of formulating the budget in this council, it's made meetings and deliberations quite difficult. Until last week, we were pretty much a divided council on this budget, but we found a way to come together and to compromise and to work together. We found a way to be united. And I'm sure that we'll revisit the budget in the coming months upon review of the revenues as they come in and the needs of our community. And so there are a lot of unknowns that we'll face. And if we're going to face them together and be successful, we have to come together and be united, just as we did with the budget. We won't always agree, of course, but we have to find a way to agree to move forward. And that's the only way we'll find success. And I believe it's what the people sent us here to do. It's what they expect us to do. So I just want to thank all of you for your hard work in formulating this and the compromises that occurred, and look forward to building on this to create a bright future and a successful year. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, can we, okay, Jess?
Well, I also wanted to share similar sentiments as Councilman Moss and Councilman Berlucci. I think one of the big heartburns I had with this budget was how we balance what the business community needed and what residents needed. And I think we are addressing some tax relief. I think we should be proud that we are not raising the real estate tax rate. I think we should be proud that we are not raising the ERU. As Councilman Moss said, there are many families who are disproportionately affected by some of the fees that we charge as a city, and I'm certainly not going to engage anybody in a debate on that this evening, but I think that we have made positive steps in working collaboratively together as a council, and so I'm pleased to support this budget because I think it does a lot of important things that we needed to get done, and I think it personifies the idea of a living, breathing budget that we intend to come back and work on month after month after month as we try to recover through what the long-term impacts of COVID-19 has on our economy. So I think we should be pleased with the budget as it's come out, and I'm happy to see that we are together on this, and that's really all I wanted to say.
And thank you very much, Jessica. Okay. Okay, we're ready for the vote.
Councilmember Abbott?
Oh. Aye. Aye.
Councilmember Berlucci?
Aye.
Councilmember Henley?
Aye.
Councilmember Jones?
Aye.
Councilmember Moss?
Aye.
Councilmember Rouse?
Aye.
Councilmember Tower?
Aye.
Councilmember Wilson?
Aye.
Councilmember Wooten?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Wood?
Aye.
Mayor Dyer?
Aye.
By a vote of 11-0, you have approved the ordinances and resolutions read by Vice Mayor Wood.
If I could just say prior to adjournment, I can tell you how grateful I am that we did come together. This is one of the most challenging times in the history of Virginia Beach. The journey begins with the first step, and I think we've taken the first step. This is not the end. This is just the beginning of what's going forward. And I'm glad that we found the consensus, but I think we are also of agreement moving forward that this is a living, breathing budget that we're going to have to deal with and confront on a month-to-month basis to ensure, and I think John Moss hit on it before, you know, we got to be open and adaptable, you know, to be reflective of what people really need, what businesses really needs, and be flexible and be nimble as we go forward so we all coexist. Government is a partnership with the elected people, the staff people, and the public. And I think if we use that engagement going forward, we will continue to do things in spite of the crisis, and we will come out. And I think we are better for it. And for this, I say thank you, God bless you, and looking forward to it. Thank you all.